Hello, everyone. This is Colleen Milton, and on behalf of Lexential and 451 Research, I would like to welcome you and say thanks for attending today's webcast titled Navigating the Data Explosion, a New Way of Looking at Edge Computing. Leading off the discussion today will be Craig Matsumoto, who is Senior Analyst of Data Center Networking at 451 Research. Following Craig will be Tim Parker, who is VP of Network Strategy at Lexential. Just a few quick housekeeping items before we get started. To ask a question, simply type it in the question box on your screen. We'll answer as many questions as we can during the Q&A session, and we'll respond to all unanswered questions via email after the webcast concludes. This presentation and slides are available for download. And finally, please provide feedback at the end of the webinar. And with that, I'll turn it over to Craig.
Thanks, Colleen. We are going to be talking today about the network edge, specifically about how it relates to modern-day enterprise IT. And by modern day, I'm talking about a general trend we've all seen, about the fact that enterprise IT is moving outward. It's moving away from what used to be the enterprise data center or the enterprise headquarters or premises and out toward, quote-unquote, the cloud, meaning all kinds of different forms of the cloud, including things like Salesforce.com, the SaaS providers, just anything where you're connecting to somebody else's cloud, somebody else's facilities to get to your application or your service. The point is, more and more of the enterprise's work is taking place in faraway, virtualized kind of settings. Just to put some numbers on that, at 451, our Voice of the Enterprise data shows that 62% of enterprises are moving toward what we call hybrid IT. That is a combination of public clouds and private clouds, where the private cloud is not necessarily on premises. It could be hosted in a multi-tenant data center, for example. The point is, 62% are moving toward this hybrid IT situation where multiple destinations are in play. So everything, even as it moves to the cloud, isn't in one virtual place. Think of it this way. The physical aspects of enterprise IT, like the servers and the storage, they belong to somebody else now, right? In the cloud, you're renting these things. Even in the private cloud, you'll be renting you might be renting the space and the power, the cooling, all the facilities aspects. So that's what happens to your applications as an enterprise. But what about the network? Right, the network hasn't had an analogous transformation happen. Really, all that's happened is we've replaced what used to be the enterprise network with the internet. That's sort of the default way to get to the cloud. And that might seem very cloud native and very tech savvy of us, but the flip side is by using the internet, enterprises have given up control of the network, even at a time when they rely on networking more than ever because the core business functions are sitting out in somebody else's cloud. Just a little bit more about the cloud migration. I know we all have a sense that this is the way things are going, but just to put some numbers on to show that this is actually happening, here's what we've seen with our Voice of the Enterprise surveys. 60% of the enterprises we polled say the majority of their workloads are running in some company-owned venue today, or company-controlled venue. And those same enterprises expect that number to drop to 42% in 2 years. Looking at it from the other direction, looking at it from the point of view of applications that are off-premises, in 2 years, 46% of our enterprises expect the majority of their workloads to be running off-prem, up from 27% today. Off-prem in that second category includes a lot of different things, the different ways of outsourcing or of procuring services, but mostly it means going, again, to somebody else's cloud. So these numbers and what we see on the last slide tell us, again, that a lot of important work is just moving farther away, physically farther away from the enterprise. But again, remember what we said about networking. A lot of enterprises are just using the internet to get to these applications, giving up control even when their work has moved farther away. And there are some complications with that, as you might imagine. The most obvious one is latency and performance. So let's start by drilling down on that. We're worried about two things here if you're using the internet. First, you've got the physical distance to the cloud. There's a speed of light factor that you're not going to avoid no matter what kind of network you're using. But for the internet itself, there are also just a lot of inherent complications. There's a level of unpredictability there that can be a detriment. The number of hops, for example, that matters, because traffic that goes through multiple network nodes is going to incur more latency. You get more latency with every switch, every node that you encounter, and you can't stop this. And the internet has no incentive to minimize the number of hops your traffic goes through. It's essentially going to be random. That taps into the bigger issue, just that the internet is a best effort operation, right? Sometimes the traffic doesn't arrive at all, and the assumption is that you're going to be okay with that. But of course, increasingly, we're not okay with that. Take, for example, the idea that the application we're talking about in the cloud might be customer-facing, right? So this is your brand, your brand's face out on the internet. Every delay, every glitch is putting that brand at risk. Customers know deep down that that's kind of how the internet works, but if you have consistent, persistent kinds of performance problems, it's going to be a black mark on the enterprise brand. The same thing is true in a sense when you're talking about internally facing applications. The software, I mean, this is the software that you're running your enterprise on in a literal sense. So you don't want it to be glitchy, right? These are applications that people need to use every day. And for some job functions, increasingly, they're relying on cloud-based applications to get at information very, very quickly. You don't want consistent performance problems to start building up this frustration and resentment among your own people. Think also about analytics, right? If you look at the retail sector, you've got a combination of Wi-Fi and point of sale systems, customers' previous purchase records, location data inside of a store or maybe inside of a shopping mall. If you combine all that information, you can get some pretty valuable insights. And in a perfect real-time world, you could turn those insights into promotions, into like coupons or recommendations, things that you could text directly to a consumer's phone. But in order to do that, in order to make it work, you need to gather data and very quickly get the answers back out. So latency matters here. This is an example where distance to the cloud really could matter. And Tim Parker at Flex Central is going to talk later. He's got some better and cooler use cases, so I'll let him get into that later. But of course, latency and performance are not the only problems with moving applications off premises. Security can be an issue, particularly when it comes to compliance, right? We all know about data sovereignty. Some data just can't leave certain countries. And even if it isn't the law, even if you don't have a legal restriction, you can see how in some circumstances, keeping the data closer to you is just a best practice. It's just a good idea for security and privacy. Think of healthcare or the financial industry. So there are security motivations at play if you're using the internet to reach your applications. And finally, I want to bring up something about the cloud that came as a surprise to a lot of people as they built up cloud usage, but it's becoming less and less of a secret. And that's the concept of egress fees. This is something you're going to encounter when you're working with any of the big public clouds, especially AWS and Microsoft Azure. The way they work is data that you put into the cloud is free. You can do that as much as you want. You're paying for the storage, right? But once the storage is in place, it doesn't cost you anything to fill it up with data. Getting that data back out of the cloud to do something with it, that's what costs you money. That's the egress fee. So you think of that retail example, for example, if you're crunching data in the cloud, every time you're getting an answer back from your analysis of that data, it's going to cost you something. It's on the order of fractions of a cent per gigabyte, yes. But it does add up, and it turns out to be one of the most unpredictable items on the cloud computing bill. So egress fees get complained about a lot. There's some resentment that's built up among certain user populations. And folks like content delivery networks, they're making efforts to mitigate this. There are some ways to kind of shave some dollars off of that bill, but it's still a fact of life. And one way to avoid egress fees is just to do your data processing somewhere other than the public cloud. brings up a point, though. If you're going to cloudify all your applications, but you don't want everything in the cloud, well, where do these applications go then? And the word we use for that is the edge, which I know, it's an overused term. It seems to mean a lot of different things. And you know what? That's okay. At 451, we've kind of come to terms with that. There are multiple definitions of the edge. Because depending on who you ask, you're going to get different answers. And they're all legitimate. Different problems can be solved by different strata of edge computing. So on this page, the left-hand side represents the device level. It's where the end users or IoT sensors are. And the right-hand side is essentially the cloud. So looking at that left-hand side, down at the device level, one form of the edge is all the way out there, right? Compute power might be available on the sensors that are gathering data, or maybe right next to them. So you could do your data processing right where the action is. Pokemon Go kind of does this. Your phone is doing a lot of the number crunching, and that's part of why it eats up your battery so fast. For a lot of situations, though, we're going to want to move the data somewhere else, either because we just need more computing power than you could have on the device, or because we're trying to aggregate results from lots of different endpoints. Think again about retail, where you might be tracking inventory at a whole fleet of stores. Or a better example is Google Waze, the traffic analysis, right? Where there's no one edge device that makes sense as a compute host. There's no one car where you're going to do the processing for what's happening with a lot of other cars. So for those kinds of data crunching, we have to move more to the right-hand side of this chart, deeper into the infrastructure. This slide is essentially the same as the previous slide, but we're looking vertically now. End users are down at the bottom, and that's where the IoT sensors are too, and clouds and cloud-like entities are up at the top. So we're moving from the bottom upwards to the top. So when I talk about moving deeper into the infrastructure, I'm talking about this blue band you see, this blue band called the near edge. These are the venues that can host larger forms of compute, racks of equipment, for example. And you can see even the near edge has substrata to it, right? If latency is of utmost importance, you might want to house a rack of gear someplace like a base of a cellular tower, very close to the end user. This is where micro environments would come into play. But those environments, they have space limitations. They are micro, after all. You would need a lot of them to cover a widespread user base. They don't exist in some geographies, really. And maybe most importantly, they're not going to have certain networking advantages that we're going to talk about on the next slide. So what I really want to call your attention to is the idea of using a data center, a multi-tenant data center, as this near edge. So this would be up near the top of the chart. The orange cloud represents the hyperscalers, the public clouds, and the like. The blue box next to it, you can see, is sort of on the same level. These are where multi-tenant data centers would be, or a lot of structures resembling data centers, things like telco central offices. But let's talk about the multi-tenant data center as your venue for the near edge. I'm talking specifically about a carrier-neutral venue that offers co-location. These kinds of data centers are already outfitted to host compute and storage, right? They can accommodate scale. But the factor that I'm really interested in, that I want to emphasize, are the other tenants. These multi-tenant data centers, they're already home to SaaS providers and cloud on-ramps, direct connections to the cloud. These would be the enterprise's neighbors if an enterprise is co-locating in this data center. And of course, the data center would offer connectivity to these various parties. So what you get out of this is what we're going to call network-enabled co-location, where the value comes not just from the facilities, from the power and the cooling in the data center, but from the number of different entities that the enterprise can connect to. In fact, if you take the idea further, in some cases, other enterprises could be tenants. You could connect to your suppliers or your customers. Or if they're not in the data center, you know who is, are the service providers, telcos and other network providers. So enterprises could access those services to reach other enterprises or to reach new populations of end users. What's important about all this connectivity is that it doesn't happen over the internet. We're talking about cross-connects inside the data center, or increasingly virtual cross-connects, using software-defined networking to create an overlay network almost instantly. Either way, the connectivity is provided from inside the data center. It's private, going over private connections. And that means you regain some control compared with the internet. The user experience becomes more controllable now, more predictable, and certainly more secure. By the way, I mentioned the public cloud on-ramps. I'm talking about services like Amazon Direct Connect or Azure Express Route. Really, this kind of is the use case that Direct Connect was created for, right? It's a way for an enterprise to consume a lot of cloud resources without the unpredictability of the internet, including the unpredictability of bandwidth and costs. When we talk about this idea of network-enabled colocation, the analogy I like to use is Grand Central Station in New York City, right? It's one very big place that's a hub. It's a hub for different lines of transportation. You have trains that terminate there. You have subway lines that go through there. Buses, bus lines there, taxis. Heck, you can even walk to some really important places from Grand Central Station. It's a hub. It's a place where you can switch from one mode of transportation to another. Think of it as it's like a big switching fabric for humans. Network-enabled colocation can act as that kind of hub for the enterprise. One home base for connectivity to the cloud, to SaaS providers, to service providers, to suppliers, customers. The enterprise can even use this hub to connect to itself, right? If all your branch offices are connecting into there, this can be their vehicle for communications. The main idea is that network-enabled colocation plays into the enterprise's increasing dependence on the cloud. This need to reach multiple different clouds while also alleviating the problems we talked about earlier with internet connectivity, the latency and performance issues, the security complications, and even those cloud egress fees. So that's where we're coming from when we talk about network-enabled colocation and how it can help the enterprise in this new age of the cloud. So I'd like to turn it over now to Tim Parker at Flex Central. He's going to tell us about how they view this challenge and what some of the new services are that enterprises could offer by using network-enabled colocation. So, Tim?
Thanks, Craig. Some great information. So today we're going to talk a little bit about how do we just navigate all of that data that's going to be coming into the networks from those multi-deployments of both AI and IoT. And today's challenge really is around the fact that as we kind of move into this age of artificial intelligence and the Internet of Things, it just advances this technology revolution so fast that connectivity from the edge to the core is never going to be more important. You know, far-edge deployments, they'll need that connectivity into those near-edge data centers, as Craig pointed out, because of the space power, large amounts of compute that need to be done, can't be done in all these little micro data centers. And the billions of connected devices just will dictate a need for great connection. And we're going to go into some details on that. And it all comes down to understanding how all of this is going to tie into the core, which goes back to the network-enabled colo and the interconnection being the key. As we start to deliver a new class of service to, you know, ourselves and improve our livelihoods and all of the abilities that AI and IoT and all of this connection type of capabilities bring, interconnection is going to be the key. And we start to talk about things like smart cities, visual AI, safety and manufacturing. It's amazing some of the advances in technology that is happening today. For instance, in a smart city, you can walk in to your building and facial recognition will allow you to have access to the building, call the elevator that takes you directly to your floor where your apartment is and give you access into your apartment without having to go through bundling through keys, et cetera. But it's also adds security in the fact that somebody else couldn't access your building because their face is not going to be recognized. And visual AI on the retail side is just advancing so fast. Retail stores can now take and put out displays for, you know, a cosmetic and maybe show it in three different versions, and by facial expressions, understand which one is attracting the most amount of customers. And then on top of that, also get a lot of demographics, you know, the age of the customer, the type of the customer, who is really looking to purchase that so that they can improve their ability to both market and to sell stuff. And then you get into safety. You know, we talked about that a little bit about accessing buildings, but you also have the ability in some of these smart cities now actually know where your children are based on facial recognition. And while we get into a little bit of nervousness about, well, that kind of sounds Minority Report, think about the ability that to feel that your children are playing in a playground in your neighborhood and you totally know where they are at all moments and you're not having to worry about that. And then, of course, we go into manufacturing where, you know, the ability to look at circuit boards and stuff through, you know, visual AI versus having a person try to make sure that everything looks good. It just improves the process so fast. But then the one area that really gets me and really makes me feel like it's a noble effort that we're doing is when we start talking about health. You know, health monitors, remote diagnostics, robotic telesurgery. There's a podcast out there by Rosalind Picard on TED Talks, and it talks about an AR smartwatch that can detect epileptic seizures. And what I was not aware of until I listened to this is 50,000 people die per year from SUDEP, which is an epileptic seizure issue, where they just suddenly die. And this monitor can actually detect it and send a message to a parent through their phone and alert them that their child is having a seizure. And an actual use case was a mother was just getting into the shower, her phone went off, she was able to go in, gently shake her daughter, and save her daughter's life. Where if she didn't have that, she would have lost her daughter to that seizure. And if the network's not there, that ability to do that would be, you know, just a horrible experience if you ended up losing a child because you couldn't do that connectivity. So interconnection is going to even be more important. And of course, we get into autonomous vehicles that have a lot of press, you know, the ability to have a car drive itself. But if you don't have that connection again, you have the capability that a car in 1 second can travel 60 feet. A lot can happen in 60 feet if you don't get the right information. And while people talk about all that compute's going to be in the car, that's going to be historical data. You're still going to have to, if a situation changes, for instance, some type of weather event or some type of issue with people that are in that area, that recognition needs to be immediate and instantaneous. And of course, you've got drones and public transportation and all of that that's going to benefit from this. And then we go into gaming, which is huge for all of this, you know, IoT, AI, and connectivity out there and virtual reality. All of those are going to drive so much data back into our networks. And if you start thinking about it, we haven't even hit 5G. I mean, when you start to think about 5G and the ability for it to bring 20 times the amount of data into our networks and the intelligent AI and machine learning and all that that's going to start driving things back, we start to see that we're going to go from billions of packets to trillions of packets fairly quick. And that's where we start to see some issues. In 2020, it's estimated from a lot of research analysts that our traffic is going to go from being unidirectional or mainly content being pushed out to bidirectional. And that means all of that traffic comes back in. And one of the things we haven't started to do yet is while we know how to compress and do content delivery at the edge, there is nothing on your phone that compresses data yet or sends that back. So that's, and those IoT devices are not going to be there. And then we start thinking about the amounts of traffic and the amounts of data that's coming back in. It's just enormous. And so we've got to start figuring out some architectural strategies to combat that and how are we going to move forward to be able to address that type of, you know, excessive amount of data moving in and out of our networks. And in this slide, we're going to just talk a little bit about how, you know, and today we've got storage, cloud, big data, analytics, all of that sits out in our core. We use our near-edge data centers to kind of distribute and deliver those services, as we talked about the content and everything. And then the consumption and connectivity is out there in those towers, your mobile devices, your tablets, et cetera. But tomorrow that changes, and it's changing right now. You know, storage, cloud, big data, all that stuff is going to sit in the core because some of that is extremely expensive. You've got to add security on there. You don't want folks to be able to access certain amounts of data that's out there, especially PCI or HIPAA or any of that type of data. So those are still going to play an important role, even though things start to distribute. But as you start moving forward, things like analytics, edge cloud, I mean, you know, AWS, Azure, Google are all building edge deployments for that. They're going to start moving closer and in proximity into these two markets versus being out into the tier one markets. You start, you know, thinking about data collecting, fog, gaming, all of that because of latency needs to be in proximity. So it becomes really important to get closer to the consumers, closer to where those the machine learning and the AI responses need. And then at the far edge is BERT 5G, your micro clouds, your small data centers like the Vapor IOs or the Edge Micros are going to be out there managing that. You're going to have some data generation and visual AI type operations. One thing around visual AI, while you'll have all of this video, most retail or information gathering services, they don't really need the video. They just need the data. And so you'd want to crunch all that data and then send it back. And then, of course, AI operations. You know, certain things like those cars and like the health monitors and stuff need immediate response. It can't take that 20 to 30 milliseconds of latency hit that it may take to go all the way back to the core and back, when that can equate to a couple seconds, which, as we mentioned before, could end up being life-threatening. So that all comes back to interconnection, right? That interconnection from the edge to the core and back again is extremely important to us. And there's three keys that I like to call out. You know, first, you want reliable transport. You want the ability for customers to access a host of services through an interconnected fabric. Craig touched on a little bit that private secure network and how important it is for that. Edge strategies and architectures have to change. So we have to start taking advantage of the edge computing, the delivery to the core of our private backbones. As I mentioned, we can't send all of that data back. So we have to start figuring out what do we dump and drop at the edge. And all of the different research analysts, you know, estimate that 95 to 98% of all IoT and AI data will be useless. Only about 2 to 3% is important, but that 2 to 3% is critical. But if you start to congest our networks with all of that data, then you're going to lose the important data. So you've got to start making some decisions on how I'm going to manage and compute and drop what's not relevant and send what's relevant to the right things or act upon the right type of information. And then, of course, on top of all of that, which makes it all work, is a highly available interconnection. You've got to have a mesh network. You have to have failovers. You have to have multiple levels of redundancy because, again, we talked about it. If you lose a connection and you can't deliver a service, then all of this work you've done to build these great applications or the great sensors or monitors is really a failure because your connectivity goes down and a customer experience or a customer livelihood or life could even be in jeopardy. And, you know, and low latency, as we talked about, you've got to have all that ability to do it efficiently and you know, quick response. And latency is a killer of any good application. And so you've got to be able to just understand that low latency connectivity is extremely important. And again, why is it important, right? Outages or delays can be life or death. We talked about that. Delivering those mission critical and life-saving services to the edge is just changing the world. And our lives and our livelihoods really depend on that. So as we start to move forward, it's never been more important to have a highly available, low latency network connectivity. And networks are now seen as essential as power, right? We just expect them to be available at all times. You know, how many of us look at our phones or when we're on the internet can't understand why the network's slow or why it's down. So we just expect it to be there. When you turn on your computer, you expect it just like turning on a light switch, that it's going to be there and it's always going to be up. And a network outage or a significant delay, of course, can really mean that we could miss an important alert or instruction. And we can lose, you know, as a business, thousands and thousands of dollars. Think about trading platforms and think about, you know, retail stores and the loss of the ability to make a sale because the network's down. But now we're starting to talk about life-changing events and health monitors. So it's just not about a business, you know, and people can say, well, you know, that's a business risk that you take. Well, now we're taking life risks if we don't have these networks up because we're starting to depend on all of these functions. And of course, you know, architectural changes to the applications at the edge, they won't solve the whole problem. We need to make sure that we still have that ability to analyze that data, but that still has to be able to be transported back. You know, that 2% of data, which will still be, you know, enormous amount, has to be transported back to the core compute or public clouds because that's where you're going to do your deep analytics. That's where you're going to store your critical information, and that's where you're going to be able to keep all of that data because you can't do that at the edge, again, as Craig mentioned, because of the size of the edge, you know, small. So either you do it in the near-edge data centers at a certain level, and then you do it at your larger level at those large compute infrastructures or hyperscalers. So in summary, you know, in a connected world, network-enabled co-location is key. You know, it's all of this AI, IoT, and 5G, they're just going to change our world as we know it. So the billions of those connected devices, and they estimate, you know, 2025, maybe 75 billion connected devices. That's an enormous amount of data that's going in, so we've got to be able to manage that. And so having network-enabled colo allows customers and allows the folks with the applications to have reliable connectivity solutions that are going to support their critical business services. And it's both at the core and the edge. So it's not a one or the other, it's both. You've got to have the ability to manage both your core deployments and your edge deployments, and they're both going to play a critical role in that hybrid IT function going forward is what's really going to be the success of a business or the success of an application. And then access to peering, carriers, clouds, SaaS providers, all those other services, like that Grand Central Station analogy that Craig had, is critical. You've got to have the ability to do all that. And we just expect it now. We're just moving into a world where people expect to have all of these services available to them. And for both today's business and mobile world, it's going to be there. And our lives and our livelihoods depend on it. It's no longer an option to have this. It's a must. And that's where we're moving into. So at Flexential, we've taken a step forward where we've said we're going to be a network-enabled colocation provider. We have our 40 data centers throughout the U.S. and one in Canada. And our idea was that we were going to build a network to help customers be able to transmit data back and forth. And we have our access into 10 carrier hotels and on-ramps for those public clouds. And our idea around all of that is to make it easy for consumers and customers to be able to access that without having to go out and do it on their own. Highly available, with the capabilities for failover, with the capabilities to scale. And we developed a product called Flex Anywhere that actually brings all those services to those customers under one umbrella. And just a quick little view of our network so you can kind of see where it's out there. We've got our own 14 private clouds that we developed. We've got colocation cloud, network POPs, and edge locations out there. Plus, we have access to subsea cables, which if you start to think about the internet world now, the subsea cables carry about 90% of all of our internet traffic that goes internationally. And those are extremely important, and advances in all of that is just bringing data closer to us. Even if it's from Australia, it still feels like it's right around the corner. So that's it for today. That's what I really believe is changing our world. And what I think that if we start to really look at what's happening in today's environments with AI, IoT, 5G, all of these advances, it's really bringing us to a position that our lives are going to change, but we've got to have the connectivity options for it. So thank you for listening. If you have any Q&A, we've got a few moments to answer a few of those.
Great. Thanks so much, Craig and Tim. It's now time for our Q&A session. As a reminder, simply type in your question in the box on your screen, and we will get to as many as we can. Our first question for today is, do you see the MNOs having a presence in colocation edge data centers for their 5G deployment and operations? If so, what functions or applications will they put there?
I can start on that. This is Craig. So MNOs, we're talking about the mobile network operators, right? The short answer is I don't know, but they could, and you can argue that they ought to. In terms of what they would put there, there's two things that come to mind. First is for the radio access network, 5G is probably going to run on a what they call a cloud RAN. The acronym has changed a couple times over the years, so I'm not up on like the latest hip term, but the cloud RAN. The idea is that you disconnect the baseband from the radio, and all the baseband processing can be done someplace else. That way you can have one location that serves the baseband for many radios, right? So that someplace else is going to be something like a data center. It might be one of the micro enclosures. It might be a multi-tenant data center. Theoretically, it could be the public cloud. I don't think it's clear exactly where that's going to reside yet. The other thing that comes to mind is the Evolved Packet Core. This is a set. It's a bad name because it's not the core of the network and it's not one function. It's five or six different functions that work in conjunction, and they do things like connect your mobile session to authentication and to the billing system, the back-end systems of the telco. So the idea is that the Evolved Packet Core is going to turn into a bunch of virtual functions. It started out as individual boxes that had to be networked together. They're going to turn those into virtual functions that can blink on and off as necessary to serve customers. Fine. Those have to live somewhere also. And again, it could be that probably wouldn't be in micro enclosures because this is the kind of thing that does happen a little deeper in the network. So I'm picturing that possibly happening in multi-tenant data centers, possibly in the telco central office, which they're trying to turn into a data center-like entity, or again, possibly in the public cloud. So we don't know how that's all going to play out yet. One thing I would toss out there is that the large telcos, large mobile operators they've got some incentive to not give money to Amazon or to Microsoft Azure, specifically Amazon. So that might motivate them to go to a multi-tenant data center as an option.
Hey, Craig, I was going to add on to that. Pauline, I'm sorry. I was just going to add on to that. You know, if you look at the Verizons, the AT&Ts, et cetera, they're building their own host of applications themselves also, and they're not going to be able to distribute that and put these large amounts in compute. So as they start to recognize the fact that they have to have more than just a mobile presence to be successful and to distribute that, they're going to need to put those in multi-tenant data centers just for the space and power applications alone. You know, in these rural areas, you're just not going to get enough power to run some of the applications that are out there in the compute that's needed. And so you have to go to a multi-tenant data center that's, you know, abilities to do 10, 18, 20 megawatts. You can't do that in a rural area where, you know, even 100 kilowatts is probably more power than the whole rural area gets.
Great, thank you. Next question. Craig, you mentioned something being done about egress fees. What is that?
Oh, yeah. That is specific to the content delivery networks, so the CDNs and the companies like Akamai. I mentioned Akamai as a knee-jerk response because they are the largest of the CDNs, but I don't think they're actually doing this. The CDNs can cut deals with the public clouds. So egress fees are a problem for the CDN, because the CDN sells its services to a content provider like Disney, for example. Disney has a lot of videos that they store in the cloud. They filter it through a CDN so that you get better performance when you try to watch these videos on the web. So if the videos are stored on a public cloud, there's an egress fee attached to it, and it adds up. So the CDNs are able to cut deals with the public clouds to get better rates on egress fees. So Cloudflare, one of the CDNs specifically, is trying to start what they call the Bandwidth Alliance, just gathering CDNs together, public clouds together who just agree to either heavily discount the egress fees or just waive them completely. It's not consistent. So clouds that are members of this alliance, it's up to them how much they want to discount the egress fees. And Amazon is not one of them. They're not included. But still, the point is there's some motion there. There's some efforts there's a recognition that customers are really resentful of egress fees. So there's some motion toward trying to do something about that.
Next question. 5G, IoT, and AI seem to be at pretty early stages in the tech adoption lifecycle, likely not mature enough for most early adopters. If customers can't quite imagine how their particular industry will be impacted, how do you recommend getting these conversations started? What is the path to a sale?
Craig, I'll just start with one thing around that 5G IoT seeming pretty early. While we think it's pretty early, the fact is we're just not paying enough attention out there. I mean, I mentioned in one of my earlier slides that we have 34 billion IoT devices connected today, and that number is just going up, you know, extremely fast. And if you take things like one example I didn't even talk about was in China, you don't have vending machines like you have today. You have basically these giant refrigerator using some visual AI, and you just walk up, you do your WePay or your Alipay, you grab what you want out of it, and all the inventory and everything's done. There's no mechanical part. And then they're already viewing, you know, traffic patterns and everything. So just that alone, and then, you know, AI every day in the back end of even when you do a research on just looking to buy a car, the next advertisements you're going to see on Facebook or any social media is going to be car ads. So all of that is moving faster than we can imagine, and it's here. It's just going to continue to grow. But like you said, for those folks that can't quite get their hands around that, the best thing you have to do is start to ask them, you know, what advantages do you see from having this data gathered for you and sent back to you? and then how do you start to look at your edge deployments? Because again, as I mentioned earlier, if you're trying to do this in a global scale, you can't do it over the internet and get a, you know, good amount of some data, and it's going to get very costly to do that. So you've got to start looking at distributing your applications out there, and you really do need to go find some help to do that. Most smaller or average-sized enterprises don't have the folks that understand how to do that. But if you start to bring those ideas and those conversations to the table, at least you're starting to be aware of the issue and the problem more than just the path. And for every, whether it's retail or it's manufacturing or it's mining or even agriculture, they're all going to have different paths, and you're going to have to sit down and work with them through it. So while it's not a clean, clear answer, I will say that it's here and we've got to start, and that, you know, start recognizing the problem and start working towards solutions with customers and finding out what the path is.
Yeah, and Tim, I'll just add to that. For IoT specifically, we got a result out of one of last year's Voice of the Enterprise surveys where 42% of the enterprises said they were using some form of IoT. And I personally am not part of the IoT team, and I'm not part of the enterprise software team. So to me, that number sounds high, but it's the result we got, and it came with comments such as, your enterprise is using IoT, whether they realize it or not. That was a comment from one of the other enterprises in the survey. So the stuff is out there. It's just out there at a lower level than what you might read about in Wired magazine, for example. So in terms of path to a sale, I guess it depends on what you're selling, but to sell someone on the idea of the technology being real, I would bring up the point of automation. Pretty much anything in your day-to-day office life that you start to automate is probably using some form of IoT or AI. And I mean, IoT can be as simple as, you know, getting feedback from a printer, just to make up an example. And AI, today, in the here and now, AI tends to mean just machine learning, just a computer understanding what is typical and what is atypical and telling you the difference between them. So there's, I would agree with Tim, there's more of both of those around than you might think.
Next question. Who do you see emerging as edge cloud providers?
Craig, you want to take that? I mean, I think the obvious ones are, you know, AWS and Azure Stack and Google all have edge deployments.
What's interesting, well, it depends how cynical you want to be about the question, because it could be just about anybody. I think the most likely answer is that the public clouds will become edge cloud providers. And I would especially, so I would look at like AWS and Azure. I would look at some of the second tier contenders too. This is kind of a blind guess. So this is my personal speculation, but if you look at someone like Oracle, right, the Oracle cloud, they are going to have to be part of a multi-cloud deployment, right? They understand this, that they have to be, because you're not going to give up everything you ever did in Amazon just to put it all on Oracle. You could theoretically, but no one's going to do that. So they have to be part of a multi-cloud deployment, and they need to look for advantages for ways to basically be added on to what someone's already doing with Azure or AWS, offering edge services might be a way to do that. Again, that's just a guess, but a lot of other parties could end up being edge cloud providers in different ways. I'm actually thinking of the telcos. I know they sold off their data centers mostly, but not all of them. CenturyLink actually still runs a cloud, like a literal public cloud. Telstra in Australia does too. Telstra is not adding to it. It's basically they're preserving the cloud for the existing customers, but still, it exists, and telcos have the connectivity that goes all the way down to the end user, right? That's their job. That's their actual job. So they might make some sense as edge cloud kind of providers. But yeah, it's probably going to be the public clouds. For actually, as I say that, I have no evidence this is actually happening, but it would be interesting if some of the SaaS providers or some of the application owners started running something like an edge cloud. I'm thinking of the Oracle example, where they built a cloud to run their own stuff, and now you can run other stuff on it. It would be interesting to see if other people try that. I should also mention CDN, the content delivery networks want to be edge cloud providers. Right now, for most of them, that only means running serverless functions, like the equivalent of AWS Lambda. But they have the facilities to do this, and they would like to strengthen the kinds of things that you're able to do with that programming. So watch the CDNs too. They'll come up with different forms of edge computing.
Great. So another question has just come through. How important is it to partner with a data center provider that owns its facilities versus leases or subleases space within another facility? It seems that a data center provider like Flexential has more control over the facility and connectivity and can provide more certainty that the network is always on as operating as expected.
I'll take that one. So, yeah, it's absolutely true. When you own your own data center or you have a long-term lease on the space and the land, you're in control of your own destiny at that point, and you can really look at what's critical to your business functions and your customers. And the ability to ensure that you have a great PoE, you have great support and power and all of that connectivity, you know, we've put a lot of effort into ensuring that we have that, diverse entrance facilities into every data center, just to ensure 100% uptime across the board is critical for both our customers, and it's expected now. As it mentions in here, you get a sublease, and sometimes you get ownership changes, or you get changes in the way that they approach things, or maybe they don't want to put the, $5 to $7 million necessary to upgrade the power to start to be able to offer, the dense power that's needed in today's environments as these computes are starting to drive, 20 to 30, kilowatts per rack. You've got to be able to support that. And so when you own your own data center, you can invest in that as you see customers moving. And, when you're leasing space, sometimes that partner that owns the building or owns the facility that you're leasing from may not see the value in that. And so then you're into a negotiation with them. And also they may see the opportunity to sell that off, and then new ownership changes could occur. Cross-connect fees to go between different floors could end up being an issue. So owning and leasing your own space, it is critical. And I think it's an advantage of a company that's dedicated to being a data center provider in their own facilities, such as a Flexential or others out there.
The next question is for Tim. Can you talk about Tier 4 versus Tier 5, and where is Flexential on the certification?
We always talk about Tier 3 versus Tier 4. Tier 4 is an extremely hard to get certification and uptime. We have multiple data centers that are Tier 3 certified. We take a lot of pride in all of our Generation 4 data centers being Tier 3 designed, or Tier 3 and Tier 4 designed with Tier 3 certification. To go to a Tier 4 certification is really dependent on your customer base. And so while we'll do designs for that, we typically don't push for the Tier 4 certification until we get a customer that needs it. But we do have, I think we have the largest amount of Tier 3 certified data centers in the U.S. We have 5 of them that can withstand it. And then we do a little adjustment based on region. For instance, if we're up there in, or if we're in Portland, we've designed it to withstand earthquakes. Even though it's not a big earthquake area, we want it to be up all the time. But if we're in somewhere like a Florida or Denver where we see tornadoes or hurricanes, we want it to be designed to withstand 150 plus mile per hour winds. But then it's all the power issues. We've got multiple power things, and we do a lot of stuff around sharing the power so we're never down. And that's the stuff that's important. So while not as familiar with the Tier 5 certification, what's it required of it, we do have one of our architects that's on the Uptime Institute and works hard to make sure that our critical data centers that we really focus on have all of the certifications they need. And as I mentioned, we have a large number of Tier 3 certified data centers.
Great, thank you. And we have time for one final question today. What is the difference between AWS and FlexCentral?
Well, AWS is actually you want to take that, Craig? Go ahead.
Actually, I was going to start by saying I should probably let Tim take that. But the simple answer is that with FlexCentral, you would own your servers, and with AWS, you wouldn't. And there's trade-offs with that, but I'll let Tim explain.
Well, and so at FlexCentral, we do have private clouds. So we have private developed clouds for customers that maybe can't get a service at AWS yet. One of those great examples is folks that are dealing with HIPAA type of compliancy. So healthcare sees it as a real advantage. The other difference with our private clouds is we're in proximity. So if you look at our footprint, we're in a lot of tier two cities. So we have a private cloud capability in Denver. We have private cloud capabilities in Minneapolis, places where you may not find an AWS and Azure, and you want some ultra low capabilities there. But the biggest key between that is they're a hyperscaler, and they're going to be able to spin things up and down, and they have these huge footprints of 100 megawatt type of deployments. We're at a much smaller scale, but delivering a very specific solution for customers in region that they need, because they just don't want to be able to move everything up there. It's also there's you'll see some stuff coming out where we'll talk about why some enterprises find that they need to move back away from AWS just because of cost. I mean, the cost can get enormous as your footprint starts to grow, and having that hybrid IT solution where you have a little bit of cloud, maybe in a private cloud like FlexCentral has, some applications out in AWS or Azure, and then some of your stuff back into core compute is going to start to be this boomerang effect where people start to see that moving everything to the hyperscalers isn't as efficient or cost effective as they thought, and they need this hybrid solution. And that's where, back to why we talked about connectivity is core, it's not one computer or one compute and one data center anymore. It's a host of services distributed through a bunch of different capabilities, whether it's public, private, your own compute, your own storage, that all ties together that makes it a really strong ecosystem to develop services and deliver services to your customers.
Great. Thank you so much to both of our speakers. That concludes today's webcast. As a reminder, the on-demand replay will be available on ON24 soon. On behalf of FlexCentral and 451 Research, thank you so much for attending, and have a great day.
Thank you.